I'm so glad that you're here. Everyone has an interest in laying hands on people and seeing them healed, right? Yeah, excuse me one second. I need to move this. Back in 2009, the Lord spoke a word to me. I was walking through my... Make sure that doesn't hit the shirt. I was walking through my bedroom on a Tuesday morning, and the Lord said two things. He said, see yourself as I see you, not as you see you. And then he said, believe my word. And I thought, see yourself as you see me, not as I see me. Believe my word. Well, I thought I did believe your word. And so this whole thing just brought confusion. And within a couple of weeks, the Lord cleared it up. You familiar with the name Todd White? Okay. I'm so sorry. Well, I was drugged to a Todd White meeting. And afterwards, I made a spirit-led trip to the men's room. And I came out of the men's room, and there was Todd White. And I told him what I did for a living. And I said, I need to do what you do. So he said, let me see your hands. And so I reached my hands out. He laid his hands on top. And he prayed a very interesting prayer. He prayed, Father, I pray that you would take Craig. How did he pray this? He said, I pray that you would take Craig where I'm at right now, where Todd's at right now, and that I would not have to re-till the ground. So anyway, I did not sense anything when he prayed for me, and 2 weeks later, I was in a Staples business store. You guys have Staples up here or whatever? And this woman had a really bad back, and I make a long story short, I laid hands on and prayed for her, and she actually felt better. I mean, I was totally shocked. I had been in the ministry 27 years. I saw like three people healed in 27 years. And I went outside and I called my wife. I said, Kathy, you're not going to believe this. I actually prayed for somebody and they felt better. It's like, are you kidding me? And so a few weeks later, I'm down in Florida and I run into a young woman. She had broken 17 bones in her foot and ankle. Had 9 pins in her foot and ankle. This happened 3 years ago, and she's in constant pain. And so I prayed for her, and I said, try it out. And she started banging her foot all around, and God healed her instantly. And I'm getting blown away by this whole thing. And I'm going through puberty right now, and my voice is starting to deepen, and I'm kind of like in between... I'm so sorry, but it's like, wow, this is unbelievable. And so I started to see this as a regular way of life. And like Pastor Dave said, you know, it's not like, I mean, we have healing services. We're going to have one tonight, but it's just wherever we go and we see the need, love demands that we love on these people, you know? Well, a couple years ago, I was riding down at the Jersey Shore riding my bike. I see this very large man with 2 crutches walking. And I thought, well, you know what? I'll get him on the return trip. And I said, no, I need to do it now. So I turned around, and this guy was huge. My nose fit in his belly button. It was an unbelievable fit. You know, I couldn't get too close to him. And so I said, what's going on? He had had this accident, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And I said, well, listen, do you mind if I just pray for you a second? And he said, no. And so he told me his name and his last name, and I recognized that he was Jewish. So I just got down, and it's no certain formula or anything, no certain words. You just kind of speak to it and command it in the name of Jesus to happen. And it happens. And we're going to talk about, well, what if it doesn't happen? We're going to talk about all those things this morning. So anyway, I just got down and put my hands on his ankle and, you know, kind of said whatever came to my mind. And I said, try it out. And he took a step. And he looked at me like I was from outer space. And he took a couple other steps. And tears started to well up in his eyes. And he grabbed me and bear hugged me. And I mean, I'm in his chest, and this guy's just wrapped around me. And God had totally healed him. And I said to him, that was in the name of Jesus. I said, what are we going to do with that? And he said, can I call you later? And I said, sure. So he called me up later, and this man was about 60 years old. And we started to talk. He says, you realize I'm coming against everything I was ever taught. And for a Jewish person to receive Christ as Messiah, I mean, I've had friends who their families have literally shunned them, have disassociated them with them. And he did not receive Christ on the phone with me, but he could not deny what had happened. Isn't that cool? You know? And it takes the average person in North America between 7 and 9 times of hearing the gospel before they got saved. Well, that probably counted for maybe 5 or 6 right there. I mean, that was a major impact. And like I said, it's just a way of life. You know, I could tell you just thousands of stories all the time. A young girl, 28 years old, walking into a convenience store. She had bad hips, prayed for her. She's getting ready for surgery. And all of a sudden, she's healed. She just starts crying her eyes out. And it's so cool. It's just, and you have the goods because Jesus lives in your heart. Mark 16:18. These signs will follow those who believe. Okay, so am I a believer? Yes. Okay, then this is what I'm supposed to be doing. All right? And that's it. And you just do it. But like I said, for 27 years, I didn't see anything. How come? And there's a lot of reasons for that. Remember, the Bible said anything not done in by faith is sin. Right? Okay? So there has to be an element of faith in our prayers. Now, I don't pretend to know it all. I can't give you a formula. There is no formula. We cannot put God in a box. I mean, if you needed a healing and I said, you should have bought a Honda in Jesus' name, if God wants to heal you, you know, he's going to heal you. All right? All I can tell you is that when I do not pray with an element of faith behind it, and I'll show you what that means in a minute, then I don't see anybody get healed. I see 3 or 5 people in 27 years. But when I pray with an element of faith behind it, I see about 70% of the time people getting instant relief. Isn't that cool? Yeah, yeah. My wife and I were out in Lake Tahoe, California, and I did a meeting, and we were going to see the Lord heal a bunch of people. And I said to the people last night, I said, you know what? Tomorrow night we're going to do a healing service, and we're going to see God heal a bunch of people. Do I have the right to say that? I mean, am I being cocky? Am I being arrogant? No, I don't think so, and this is why. The Bible says when 2 or 3 gather together in his name, he is in our midst. And wherever he is, he does amazing things because that's who he is. It's actually a statement of faith, isn't it? You know, I'm not manipulating God. I just know he's amazing wherever he is. So this is what's going to happen because that's what he does when he shows up. So anyway, back to this meeting in California. I try not to pray for people myself when I'm in a church because then it puts the emphasis on me, like I have something that the church doesn't. And so we have this wonderful healing service, and God heals all these people, and I've got my sparkly jacket on, and aren't I wonderful? And I get on an, even flying on an airplane. If you fly into a city, you're even more anointed versus driving in, you know? And now that I came from another country, it's even a greater anointing. Whoa! You know, whether I just rode my bike here from across the street. I mean, this is our mindset. It's ridiculous. So anyway, the Lord said to me in 2009, have nothing to do with it, because I don't want the attention on you. I want the attention put on the fact of raising up an army, and that my sons and daughters realize that they have the goods to do this all the time, wherever they are. They're created in my image. We have the same DNA as our Papa in heaven. Yeah? Jesus said that we would even do greater works than what he did. Right? You'll do greater works than these. Can you imagine? None of us are expecting to do greater works than the Master. But that's what the Lord said. And so if he wouldn't have said it if it was impossible, right? So I said that night in Lake Tahoe, I said, you know what? I need some people to help me. Who wants to pray for people? And these three little girls came up. They're like 7 years old. And I said, does Jesus live in your heart? And they go, yep. I said, then your prayers are as good as mine. So we would go up to somebody, say they had a torn rotator cuff, and they put their little hands on him. It was so cool. And I'd say, Father, and I'm like standing back, and I'd say, Father, in the name of Jesus. And they're like, Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we speak to this rotator cuff. Yeah, we speak to it. And I'm like, oh, okay. And Lord, we command this rotator cuff to be healed. Yeah, Lord, heal it. And so anyway, I'd say to the guy, try it out. And he's like, wow. And the little girls are, Mommy, did you see how Jesus used me? Isn't that cool? So they're like 7 years old, walking as sons and daughters as of Christ. Their identity, bam, solidified that night. I mean, it was cool. The guy got healed. But for me, it's even cooler seeing those little girls. And that night, it was about 250 people. And of all the people we prayed for, where you could see a manifestation, I mean, if a guy had high blood pressure, it's not like we were, you know, checking 120 over 80, but where you could see a manifestation with pain, we saw at least 95% change right on the spot. All these little girls. What's your name? What are you thinking when I said that?
No, I'm just asking a question about well, for people who they pray and didn't see the miracle happen, then what will be what are the proper attitude to?
Right. Okay, all right. So that's what you were thinking? Okay, all right, great, yeah. Yeah, all right. Yeah, I thought the Lord wanted me to ask you what you were thinking. Yeah, and we're going to talk about that because I see that too. But it's not on me because I'm not the healer, am I? It's on him. I'm just doing what he said. Jesus said, go ye. Most of the church says, no ye. Right? 95%, I mean 95% of all Christians have never even shared their faith. And now this is a whole nother level. And, you know, the problem is in the church today, we've become, oh gosh, I'm looking for Pastor David to rescue me here. we've become just a fraction of what God's called us to be. through tradition, through unbelief. I don't know where it all turned. But man, we are like nowhere near the Church of Acts. Are we? Yeah, I mean, what happened? When did this all come in? I mean, it's an amazing thing. And it's a horrible thing. And yet you and I can turn that tide. And we can be that people that are become the real deal. You know, I always share that in each church, there's the remnant and the rest. In every church, there's two groups. And God will always use the remnant while the rest are at rest. Right? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, but I appreciate you being here. I appreciate the hunger. You know, I really do. You know, I would rather be a lion for 2 years than a lamb for 20. Right? Yeah. Yeah. Let's turn to Acts chapter 3, shall we? This kind of puts it all together. How you like this scene here? Isn't that nice? David, you sent me that. That's when Pastor David invited me to go on a trip to the Philippines. That was across the street from the conference hall. Yeah. Yeah. We good? Before we get into the example of Peter and John, let's take a look at how most of the church prays for people today. You know, I started the healing side of the gospel, or I was impacted with it back in 2009. And for, gosh, a few years, I kept thinking, well, what is wrong with the other way of praying, which I'm going to show you? How come I don't see people get healed? All right? So let's say, what's your first name?
Sylvina.
Let's say that Sylvina has an extra toe. Okay? And she wants to get rid of it. All right? And so anyway, the church comes up and Sylvina comes up. She says, you know, I like to get prayer. I have an extra toe. It kind of makes me a little self-conscious, you know. So she comes up and so this is what the church does. And Sylvina's crying. She's very upset. You know, she's tripping over her extra toe when she walks. I mean, it's a real problem with sandals and, right? You know what I mean? And high heels, you got the one toe kind of sticking out. And so anyway, she comes up and the extra toe has really ruined her life. And, you know, you hear people putting their foot in her mouth. Well, she even had a problem with that. And, you know, so she comes up and this is how the church prays. And they lay hands on Sylvina. And everything they say is true. They say, Lord, we lift up your dear daughter to you, Lord. And you can see the pain that she's in. And, you know, let's change it up that she had a broken foot. And she's just in a lot of pain, okay? And so, Lord, we just pray for Sylvana, Lord. And God, we know, Lord, that you're her healer. And God, you can see, Lord, she can barely walk right. And God, she's just in so much pain, Lord. And God, we just know that you love her so much. And she loves you. And all these things are true, everything I'm saying. And so, Lord, we just pray, God, you remove that healing. I'm right, you remove that pain from her, Lord, right now. And God, you would just help her. And we ask this in Jesus' name. So we all give her a little hug afterwards. Okay, we love on her. That's a good thing, right? Nothing wrong with that. And then we say, you know, and she'll be walking away still crying. And we'll say, you know, Sylvana, we'll be praying for you at the prayer meeting this week. And that's it. Isn't that what we do? Isn't that what churches do? many times. And we love on her, we comfort her, the ladies gather around her, give her a couple tissues, maybe even three or four tissues, if they have a lot of tissues. And but that's what we do. Never once do we ever even ask her if the pain is left. Okay. We pray. We're here. We pray from earth. And we pray to God. And we'll just say up there for the sake that we always believe the heavens up there. Right? Okay. So we pray from here up to there. And we ask God to heal her. And he is her healer. Where's the problem? And then we think, well, maybe if I get down on my knees and pray for her, that'll provoke God to heal her. Or maybe if I start pounding on the floor, that'll provoke God to heal her. So what we're doing, we're praying from earth to heaven and begging God for a bone. And we're praying as orphans, not as sons and daughters. Paul says that we are now seated with Christ in heavenly places. There was a great healing evangelist by the name of F.F. Bosworth, Fred Bosworth. Anybody know that name, Bosworth? A couple spirit-led people? Okay, great. You want to check out the book. I'm teasing. You've got to have fun, you know. Please get this book called Christ the Healer. I will try to get you Pastor David's Visa card later, and we'll bill it directly to him. I had the wonderful opportunity to meet Fred Bosworth's daughter-in-law, Stella Bosworth, in Florida a couple years ago. Pastor Dave, did I tell you that? Daughter-in-law. And it's a whole divine encounter that I had. It was a God thing. I won't get into that for sake of time. But she told me a lot about Bosworth. And he used to say, well, keep looking down. You know, people say, keep looking up. It'll get better. That's going to drop off one day. Right? Keep looking up. But Fred will always say, keep looking down, brother. Keep looking down. Because he said, we are seated with Christ in heavenly places. Fred Bosworth came off the mountains of Japan in the 1980s. When he was in his 80s. And the Lord said to him, your work is completed. You finished your course. He comes home. He says to his wife, call the children. The Lord told me I've completed my race. I'm not staying down here any longer than I have to. And so the kids all come home. He tells them the story. And he climbs in bed to die. Can you imagine? This guy was really cantankerous. You know what I mean? Like you think you wouldn't want to, you know, now be able to spend time with the grandchildren or something. You know what I mean? And he climbs in bed to die. And she was there. Can you imagine? I got to talk to her. And she said every night, my father-in-law would say, whip, gives me a hug. Tonight the Lord's coming for me. And they would all hug him. And she said, he would wake up in the morning and he was still alive. And he was so disgusted. And she said that he would say, I am so disgusted. I'm still here. And so the next night, well, gives me a hug. Tonight's the night. And they would all give Dad a hug. And he'd wake up. Ow. I'm still here. I am utterly disgusted. So it got to the point, he had an out-of-body experience. Now, Christians say, well, you know, you can't have an out-of-body experience. But Paul said, whether in or out of the body, you know, I don't even know. So let's say he was at that place. And when he came back, he said to the family, he said, I saw you and you and you. And he said, I saw you all in heaven. So again, we are now seated with Christ in heavenly places. So the question is, and we'll give this to Pastor Dave because he's the senior pastor. Where are we really, brother? Are we here or are we in heaven with, you know what I mean? Isn't that interesting? So I don't know where I'm at. So she said, within this 2-week period, Dad stayed in bed and we would worship and pray. And she said, then he could no longer see us. But he only saw those who had passed away. And he was sharing how beautiful heaven was. And she said, one day all of a sudden, he just stopped talking. He laid his head back and he moved on. And the book, this is like the last page of the book. It's such a beautiful thing. It says, this was the life of F.F. Bosworth and Christ the Healer. It's just phenomenal. And I had the honor to be with them, with her, as she told this story. They were 6 generations to Africa. They worked with Reinhard Bonnke. Stella said her son-in-law did not know much about the healing side of the gospel. And they're in Africa with Reinhard Bonnke, and they had healing tents. And Bonnke looks right at him, the guy that, you know what I mean, had no interest in healing or anything else, says, you come with me. So he takes him into the healing room. And he said, this poor African comes up to him. He has no teeth. His gums are all rotted. And he says, I want teeth. And so Reinhard Bonnke's, Bosworth's son-in-law just said, well, Jesus, you know, do what you do. And all of a sudden they said teeth just started dropping out of his jaw. And, oh, the Bosworths, they've seen people raised from the dead like it's just going out and grabbing a fish fillet from McDonald's. I mean, it's no big deal. Yeah, imagine. 6 generations. Stella is 82. I was on the phone with her, and she says, Brother Craig, she says, my son wants me to go to India for a week and stay in some hotel. And I told him if he wants me to go back to India, then I need to stay at least a month and I will live in the village with the villagers. 82 years old. Amazing. Like Pastor Dave said, our identity, where we're at. But the whole thing is that we are now seated with Christ in heavenly places. So we pray accordingly. One last story about the Bosworth. Stella, when she was growing up, her father was sick. And she was one of 3 or 4 children within the family. And and the Lord woke up her mother and said, Jesus said that he's coming for your father in a half an hour at 3:30. And the Lord told me to wake you children up and go and say goodbye to your father. And so she woke up all the children, and the mother just said, Jesus is coming for daddy in 30 minutes. Go say goodbye to your father. And they all went in, said goodbye to him, 3:30, right on the money, gone. That's what they lived in. So we live so far below what God's called us to do and to be. And again, I'm so blessed to see you here today. You know, so that when I fly home on Monday, I'll know that you'll be out there just, you know, becoming more and more like him. You know? So, anyway, so let's take a look at these couple fellows here that got transformed. Acts chapter 3. And we'll notice the difference instead of praying as orphans from earth to heaven, to pray as sons in this case, or as daughters. Now, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the ninth hour, the hour of prayer. And a man who had been lame from his mother's womb was being carried along, whom they used to set down every day at the gate at the temple, which is called Beautiful, in order to beg alms of those who were entering the temple. So when he saw Peter and John about to go into the temple, he began asking to receive alms. But Peter, and along with John, fixed his gaze on him and said, "Look at us." Very first thing. They came up confident of who they were in Christ. Do you see that? Again, Pastor Dave talked about our identity. They came up confident. They didn't say hello. Okay, Peter didn't say to John, "Hey, you got a couple quarters or something to give this guy? How about a sandwich? You know, maybe he's going to spend it on drugs. We'll go get him a sandwich and a cup of coffee." You know? All they said was, "Look at us." They knew they were the real deal. And God wants you to know that you're the real deal. You know, I want to tell you something, beloved. This is your life. This is my life. It's not dress rehearsal. So we need to grab all we can, becoming more like Him and not live this mediocre life of Christianity that 99.999% of Christians live, and be the real deal. "Look at us." And all of a sudden this guy looks up and he begins to give them his attention, expecting to receive something from them. How many Christians, back then the church was called The Way, how many had walked by him maybe? Like today, we see a need, but we just walk by. Because we don't feel like we even have the goods to do it. Or we have fear or shame because of our past sins and all this stuff, which we're also going to tap into today. But they were confident in who they were, where they stood with Christ. "Look at us." But Peter said, "I do not possess silver and gold, but what I have, I give to you." What did he have? He had love, he had power, and he had authority. Now when they went to arrest Jesus, and they said they're looking for Jesus, and they said, "I am he," and the men just fell back. Demons squeal at just the sound of his name. "What I have, I give to you." And when you leave here today, "What I have, I give to you." Christ lives in you. Greater is he who is in you than he that is in the world. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Nazarene, walk. So they give all the glory to the one that deserves it, the Lord, right? And seizing him by the right hand, he raised him up. Why did he have to raise him up? Because he wasn't healed yet. So he's raising him up, and immediately his feet and ankles were strengthened. But there was the act of faith of raising him up. Again, when they prayed for her, the pain in her broken ankle, they asked God to do it from earth to heaven, not taking the authority that they had as sons and daughters. And they didn't even check to see if her ankle was healed. And I don't get all this, okay? We're in the same spot, you and I. We're still trying to figure this out. We're just in a period here of sanctification. But what I seem to see, and I say this with my face on the floor, is that it seems that God honors it when we use the authority that He's given us and we give Him the glory by speaking it in Jesus' name, and then to show that we expect Him to move, then we say, try out your ankle. Try it right now. Or in this case, they helped him up. They didn't say, get up. That's interesting. You know, in the name of Jesus, pick up your mat and walk or whatever. Okay, it's interesting. They didn't say to him. They helped him up. Wonder why. And as they helped him, see the act of faith with helping him up, and then as they did, his feet and ankles were strengthened. Now let's say, because you had a concern about this, and I'm sure everyone else does, and I've had concerns about this too. Let's say they helped him up and he fell back down. We'll try it again. Or, you know what, brother? I'm sorry. You didn't get the manifestation yet. It might come this afternoon. I was at a Baptist church who did not believe in healings, but I knew the youth pastor. And he had me come in and talk to the kids on a Friday night. And we did a meeting similar to this, and afterwards they all ran to this woman in the back of the room who had a torn meniscus tendon across her knee. It was torn in half. And she's on crutches. She can't put any weight on it. So all the kids went back there to pray for her, and I stayed out of it. And I'm talking to a couple people. I'm getting ready to walk out of the building. And I said to her, I said, how's your knee? And her husband said, those kids prayed for her, you know. We need the professional to pray for her. And I felt like going, Well, I purposed in my heart that night I decided after he said that, I would not pray for her. So thank the Lord, a couple people came up and started talking to him, and I kind of moved away. That was on a Friday night. The youth pastor told me on Monday that Sunday morning she came running up the aisle of the church. She woke up Saturday morning, and the manifestation had taken place. Cool? You got that? So the kids prayed. Nothing happened yet. And after the kids saw her walking, they were so encouraged. They were laying hands on anybody and anything. Cats, dogs, anything that didn't seem right. They're laying hands on them, you know. But think if I had gotten in the mix, I would have ruined it all. And those kids would have thought, I don't have what he's got. Sir. Yeah. Yeah, always keep them expecting. That's a great point. Yeah. I say, you know what, man? It didn't happen. Expect it this afternoon. I want to keep lifting you up. You know, and I'll say to people, I'll say, you know, if it's a guy, I'll say, listen, here's my cell phone number. You know, we can pray on the phone until this that manifests, but it's going to happen because it's God's word. You call me as much as you want. You call me 3 o'clock in the morning, and I'll stand with you, and we'll keep knocking until it happens. Somebody said to Fred Bosworth, you know, they're always throwing stuff in the mix, you know, to try to foul you up, you know. They said, Fred, what would you do if you prayed for somebody and they fell down and died? He said, I would step over them and pray for the next person. I'm not going to be moved by what I see or feel or hear. And that's a decision. I'm only moved by what I believe. God's word says, wherever I am, preach the kingdom and heal the sick. God's word said that I would even do greater works than these. God's word said, these signs will follow those who believe. And lots of times when I pray for people, I'll just say, you know, I'll say, Lord, we just come together today and we agree with your word. I put the onus back on him. He wrote the healing manual called the Bible. Lord, we just agree with your word. I don't have to get loud. I don't have to do anything. I just, Lord, I agree with your word. And if it manifests, it does. If it doesn't, well, you know what? Expect it tomorrow. You know, who knows? There was a testimony on the 700 Club. This a woman was blind since birth, and she wanted to marry a pastor, and she did. And every Friday night they had a service, and they would come home. She would lay in bed. He'd get down on his knees on the side of the bed, hold her hand, and pray for her healing. 10 years, nothing. One night, totally manifested. They take her to the optometrist. He looks in her eyes and said, nothing has changed. The parts that you need in the back of your head are still not there. And yet she sees perfect today. Just hang tough. I am not moved by what I see or feel or hear. And you know, that's a good word because somebody said life is simply this. We're either in a quote situation, or we're coming out of one, or we're going to get ready to go into one. I mean, there's always stuff going on in our life that can bring discouragement, or, you know, shake our faith, whatever, relationships, they can kind of scare. And you know what? I am not moved by what I see or feel or hear, but only what I believe. You just got to stay in that place. And that's a decision. That's a choice. I choose to stay in that position. I choose not to be moved by what I see or feel or hear. I choose just to agree with God's word. I've been praying for a couple people that God would bring them wives. And we pray and I say, Lord, your word says it's not good that man would be alone. You created a helpmate. And that goes for ladies. You know, just flip it backwards. Just agree with your word, Lord. And Lord, I thank you, God, that until that manifestation occurs, that you will give this person the grace and the anointing to walk the walk that you've given them. Just agree with his word. And that's all we're doing. So what a difference, huh? Oh, Lord, we just pray for our sister. God, her ankle hurts so much. And God, we just pray, Lord, you bring her healing. And it's a lovely prayer. These people are just loving on her, right? She's crying. And then they say, you know, we'll keep you in prayer. Focus on what? The problem. Yeah. And in these two guys, they're like, look at us. Silver and gold have we not. But in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, pick up your mat and walk. Then they help him to his feet. There's a store down in New Jersey called Boscoff's. I don't know if you ever heard of it. And so this is a few years ago, 3-4 years ago. It's December 23rd, and I was kind of getting a head start on my Christmas shopping. And I'm in Bosworth's one night, and I see this woman in a wheelchair in her 30s, and an older woman probably in her 60s pushing her. And sure enough, it's a mother-daughter gig. And I said, I just came over here. I said, I was moved by compassion. Jesus was always moved by compassion. Remember when Mary and Martha threw themselves at his feet? Lazarus had died. Lord stayed away on purpose, setting the whole scenario. And it says, when Jesus saw them, it says he was moved with emotion and wept. I remember the first time I read that 35 years ago, I remember thinking, wow, Jesus cries? I mean, some of the stuff that's in our head, right? Or what we perceive. And so I go up to them. I said, I was just moved by compassion. What's going on? And she said, I have MS. And I said, listen, is there a chance I can pray for you? And we're in this big, busy department store. And she goes, sure. And so they moved the wheelchair over. And I didn't even know what MS was. And out of pride, I did not ask them what it was. I'm just like you. I'm just getting there, you know. And so anyway, I knew I had something to do with the muscles and the legs and stuff and all this stuff. So I just got down on my knees and I put my hands on her legs. And I thought, yeah, it's probably something Todd White would do. So I'm trying to think what probably Todd would do. I mean, I have no idea what I'm doing here. You have to understand that. It's probably about where I'm at today. And so I just, you know, I just spoke to the MS. I cursed it in the name of Jesus. And I commanded her legs and ankles to be strengthened and her muscles and whatever came to my head. And then I had to take a deep swallow. And I said, do you want to try it out? And unfortunately, she said, yes. She had this belt this thick that I hadn't seen that was holding her up. She couldn't even sit up in a chair. This big Velcro belt. So I get behind her and I helped her to her feet. And I'm behind her and the chair is here and she starts walking. And now we're like, and I'm not touching her. And now we're at the wall and the chair's back here. And I always ask people what's going on. Like if I prayed for your ankle or whatever, I'd say, you know, what's going on? You know, and I said to her, what's going on? And she said, I'm walking. She said, I haven't walked like this in 8 years. And so she walked back. She sat down. We were both crying. I started prophesying over her. I came outside. It was a cold, wintry night. Dark parking lot. Walking to the car. Tears just running, flooding my cheeks. And my tears against the cold wind. And I'm like, Lord, thank you so much. It's like, you know, I'm just, I still see myself just as a kid who grew up extremely poor in a blue-collar town with cardboard in the bottom of his shoes. And that God would have me experience something like this. And I said, Lord, thank you so very much. And you know what he said to me? He said, thank you. And I knew what he was thanking me for. He said, thank you for being a risk taker. God's looking for risk takers. Lord, can I walk on the water too? Get out of the boat. Get out of the boat. Be a risk taker. Face your fears and smack them out of the way in Jesus' name. Or grow old and lay on your deathbed and look back and say, I wish I did. But now it was too late.